Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Legal Series for Founders webinar hosted by Work on Climate. We're going to get started in just a minute to allow people to time to join, but we will be starting in maybe a minute or two. While we wait, feel free to introduce yourself in the chat, share your name, where you're dialing from, and your LinkedIn URL if you'd like. Again, welcome to the Legal Series for Founders webinar hosted by Work on Climate. I'm Valerie Vidala, a volunteer at Work on Climate, and I'm thrilled to be facilitating today's session. My colleague Jess Ledoux organized this event and is here providing tech support, as well as Jonathan Stokely, who is a subject matter expert for Work on Climate. Just a quick note, this event is being recorded and we'll share it on our YouTube channel and website once it's available. Now we've got a packed agenda today, so here's a quick overview of how things will run. Each of our presenters, and there are four of them, will give a 15-minute overview of their legal specialty with a focus on supporting entrepreneurs. After all the presentations, we'll have a Q&A session, so feel free to drop your questions in the chat as we go, and we'll aim to address as many as we can, time permitting at the end. Very quickly, for those of you who are new to Work on Climate, just to let you know a little bit about us, we're a nonprofit organization dedicated to making climate work mainstream. We have over 29,000 members, and we organize events like this to help professionals transition into climate-related careers. You can find out more about joining our community by following this QR code or visiting our website at workonclimate.org. Now, our first presenter today is Ivan Golden, a partner at Taft, Stettinius, and Hollister in Chicago. Ivan specializes in corporate and tax law, and he'll be sharing insights on business entity formation. Ivan, over to you.
Thank you very much. Good to be here presenting to everybody. We are going to try to cover this material somewhat quickly, but one of the first and very important consideration for any new business is the choice of entity that you're going to form. Are you going to be corporation, partnership, something else? And you know, it is rarely a cut and dry question, especially now. And so, you know, you really are going to need to and want to think through questions about, you know, first of all, who's going to own the business? Is it going to be one person or a group of people? Do we anticipate raising money from others in the future? Will owners share income and profits and other items of the business pretty much, you know, equally or pro rata? Or are there going to be, do we anticipate making, you know, special distributions, for example? Who's going to be the manager of the business? Are we going to have a board? Is it going to be one manager or some combination? Is the business likely to earn a lot of operating income as it's starting up and as it's sort of hitting its stride? Or do we anticipate, you know, perhaps breaking even or even losing money and then a big liquidity event at some point into the future? How is the business going to reward its key employees? Do we want to ultimately reward them with equity? Do we instead just envision that they'd be, you know, more typical employees, perhaps giving them bonuses and so on? And then what's the anticipated exit? Is this a business where the expectation is we're ultimately going to sell shares to the public or sell shares to some type of a fund? Or is this something that's just going to be a private business, perhaps owned by a small group of people or even a single family? So those are the things that we always think about when we're making choice of entity decisions. So the basic considerations, or excuse me, the basic options for entities are corporation, and we'll talk in just a minute. There's now two, but in some respects, three different options for corporations. There are partnerships and limited liability companies, which are often taxed as partnerships. And then there's sole proprietorship, which I don't think I would ever recommend, or a single member limited liability company, which we'll just talk briefly about probably toward the end, but you know, it offers sort of all the benefits of limited liability right there in the name, but it is typically disregarded for income tax purposes. So if I'm running a business through a single member LLC, whatever income, deductions, other items that I have are just reported to me on my individual tax returns. So we'll start by talking about C corporations a little bit. These are sort of the oldest and most, you know, traditional form of business entity. Still, you know, widely used. I think every company that is publicly traded has to be a C corporation. So, you know, for certain businesses that either at startup or, you know, anticipate becoming large businesses, C corp is still a, you know, somewhat common choice, depending on, you know, the ultimate, as I said, kind of exit strategy. You know, do we anticipate raising money, et cetera? But C corporations, they can have multiple classes of stock. You can have common and preferred. One of the reasons that C corps have kind of fallen out of favor is that tax-wise, they tend to be sort of the worst option because there's a corporate level tax, currently 21% for federal income tax purposes. That rate obviously can go up or down depending on what happens in Congress. There's also many states that impose their own corporate income taxes of, you know, anywhere from a few percent to maybe up to 8 or 9%. C corporation shareholders then also pay tax when they receive a dividend from the corporation, again, at a rate of up to 20%, sometimes less depending on the bracket that the owner is in. But so you're looking at a combined rate that, you know, typically is going to be higher than if you're operating through an S corp, a partnership, or certain other types of entities. Another disadvantage of C corps is that any distribution of appreciated property is taxed to the corporation. So if I contribute some type of property to a C corp, let's say it's worth $100,000 when I put it in, when it goes up in value to $1 million, and then I just say, well, I want to take it back. I don't even want to sell it. I just want to distribute it back to myself. Well, even that seemingly kind of harmless transaction, it's going to be subject to tax on that $900,000 of gain. And then shareholders are also subject to a relatively new tax. I think it's been around for about a decade now, the net investment income tax, which can be up to 3.8%. An innovation or a sort of you know, flavor of corporation that has been around for decades at this point is the S corporation. Now, S corporations offer some of the benefits of C corps. You have, you know, limited liability, of course, for the owners. But for tax purposes, there are a lot of benefits to an S corp. You can have what is called, you know, flow-through taxation. Instead of the corporation itself being taxed, the S corp shareholders are taxed on their share of the business's income, and they keep track of what's called their basis. It's, you know, increased by income, it's decreased by distributions, so that kind of net on net, you're only paying one level of tax, and that is that's an advantage, obviously, relative to C corps, where you're paying those two levels of tax, one at the corporate level and a second at the shareholder level. However, the S corp form comes with a number of limitations, especially for, you know, startups and new businesses. If you can move to the next slide, we can talk about those. So S corps cannot have more than 100 shareholders, subject to certain, like, related party rules. You know, husband and wife are treated as a single shareholder, typically, things like that. With limited exceptions, they cannot have any shareholder other than an individual. So it's got to be literally an actual human being. You can't have ownership by a corporation or a partnership. And I will say, kind of parenthetically, this kind of issue comes up all the time in transactions when somebody is looking to sell their S corp. You know, it is a common occurrence that we realize, oh, in fact, you had a non-permitted shareholder and your S corp election should have terminated. And there's sort of various remedies we can find, but it's a problem for S corps. You always have to be wary of or hyper aware of who your shareholders are. S corps can't have a non-resident shareholder, and they can't have more than one class of stock, which again turns out to be a big issue because you can't, for example, issue preferred stock or profits interest to your employees or investors or people like that. Everybody is treated strictly pro rata. The other type of entity, and it's really not, that's a bit of a misnomer. It really is not a different type of entity per se, but qualified small business stock. So this is, it's a benefit under the code for qualified small business stock. If it is held more than 5 years, the owner of that stock generally can exclude all of the gain from a sale or exchange of the stock. That exclusion started out being 50 and then was increased to 75%. It's currently 100, and it's been 100 for, you know, almost a decade at this point. In order to qualify, the stock had to have been acquired after September 27, 2010, which at this point, you know, 24 or 14 years ago. So I'd imagine any startups and founders and people who are kind of working in this space now are going to qualify if they choose to, and if they sort of meet the other requirements. So there is technically a limit on the amount of gain that can be excluded. If you want to go to the next slide, please. The limit, it's the greater of $10 million reduced by any gains previously taken into account with respect to that same corporation or issuer, or 10 times the basis, which is typically the amount paid for the stock. So this is an enormous benefit. And we've seen, you know, where people now have gotten really curious about qualified small business stock, because effectively you're still a C corporation. You still have that burden of two layers of tax as you are, you know, operating. You're still paying corporate income tax and then tax on any distributions. But when you go to sell your stock, all of the gain is excluded. So if this is a home run type investment where, you know, you put a little bit of money in as an investment and then you grow the business and suddenly it's worth $10 million, all of that gain is excluded from tax, which, you know, needless to say, is a huge benefit. There are a number of qualifiers, though, as to what qualifies as qualified small business stock. So it's got to be a C corporation. As I said, it can't be an S corp, can't be limited liability company. There are some kind of complicated scenarios in which it could be a converted S corp or a converted LLC, but that's sort of beyond the scope of what we're talking about today. It's got to be a qualified small business, which means the corporation's gross assets can't exceed $50 million at any time. If assets do exceed $50 million at any time, the corporation can never in the future issue stock that'll qualify for the exclusion. So if I have a corporation, the assets are $60 million, and then it later declines to $45 million, I still can't issue qualified small business stock. However, any qualified small business stock I issued when I was below the threshold continues to keep its designation or qualification as such. There is an active business requirement. So the corporation's got to satisfy this active business test. At least 80% of its assets have to be used in a qualifying trader business. What's a qualifying trader business? Well, it's basically any business other than the ones listed here. A business of performing services in health, law, engineering, architecture, or similar fields, the banking and finance industry, farming, extraction industries, and then certain hotels, restaurants, similar businesses. So a lot of service businesses. Not sure exactly why they carved those out, but here we are. There's also certain businesses that are just per se excluded. Registered investment companies, REITs, REMICs, et cetera, co-ops are excluded. There are some somewhat, esoteric rules here around, whether and in what circumstances working capital is considered, to be used in the active conduct of a business. Corporation can't meet the active business test if more than 10% of its assets are real property that's not used in the business. And then owning, dealing, renting real estate or real property is not treated as an active conduct of a trade or business. So I want to turn the page literally and figuratively and talk about the next type of entity, which is partnership, limited liability company. I would say, for most of the time that I've been practicing, which is about 15 years, these were sort of by far the preferred choice for just about any new business, with the exception of maybe businesses that sort of knew immediately that they wanted to do a public offering. And the reason is that they kind of, in a lot of ways, offer the best of all worlds. So partnerships and limited liability companies, which anytime a limited liability company has more than one member, it's taxed by default as a partnership. So I'm kind of using those terms somewhat interchangeably. But so partnerships like S-Corps are not subject to tax as such. They don't pay. There's no partnership income tax per se. Instead, the owners of the partnership are taxed on their share of the income, and they're taxed at their individual rate, which is currently maximum of 37% federally. There may be an additional 3.8% net investment income tax for passive owners. And then, of course, there may be state tax on top of that. Character of the income passes through to the owner. So if the partnership makes some type of a capital transaction and sells a piece of property, the partner pays long-term capital gain on that item. But unlike an S-Corp, partnerships have a great deal of flexibility in terms of their management and their economics. Partnerships can create really complex, what we call, distribution waterfalls for preferred and common. You see sometimes where you've got Class A, Class B, Class C. Sometimes there might be a special preferred member who gets a preferred return before other members get a return on their investment. Partnerships, crucially, they can issue what are called profits interest to service providers. These are, in effect, it's a kind of, it's a way to reward some of your key employees or service providers by giving them a stake in the future growth of the business without giving up any equity that you have currently. So if I have a business today, it's organized as a partnership that's worth $1 million, I can say to one of my employees, I'm gonna give you, a 10% interest, not in the business today. So I'm not handing you $100,000 today necessarily, but a 10% interest in any increase in value in the business. So if the business is worth $2 million in a few years, you'll get 10% or 100,000, 10% of that increase.
Jonathan, sorry to interrupt, but if you can sort of start wrapping up for timing reasons, I apologize. I know this is the juiciest part.
Sure, no problem. So I tell you what, if you want to, why don't you go ahead and just, skip a couple of slides ahead. I think it's slide 19. We're kind of bringing it back to what we talked about at the beginning, which is that, all of these choices in the right circumstances have merit. Why don't you go back just one, if you don't mind. All of these choices can have merit, and all of them may be the appropriate choice in the right circumstance. So, you know, I think the key is to think about as best you can sort of, you know, the things we talked about at the beginning, you know, who's going to own the business? How do we anticipate the exit? What kind of income do we think it's going to generate? You know, and try to make our best, you know, best judgment as to what's going to be the most beneficial entity. Because what you don't want, and what, you know, I see sometimes in practice is, unfortunately, people have gotten into an entity that no longer is the right form or is not beneficial, or they haven't planned as the business has grown. And that, you know, that, you know, like the adage, I mean, it's sort of easier to do it right the first time than to try to plan once things are already not in an ideal, not an ideal structure. So I'm going to try to respect everybody's time. If there's questions, though, certainly, I think my contact information is here. Feel free to reach out to me, ask questions at the end, send me an email. Happy to answer any questions, time permitting.
Thanks, Ivan. And just so everybody knows, we will be ultimately sharing the deck with everybody. We'll send an email out and share it. So there's just a lot of information to share here. Next up, we have Lauren Berkeson. She's a founder of Storylock Legal in Miami. Lauren's expertise lies in trademark and copyright law, and she'll be presenting on how to protect your brand and business from an intellectual property perspective. Lauren, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you all for having me today. It's great to be here. Quick introduction. My name is Lauren Berkeson. I started practicing law in 2005 here in Miami. The bulk of my work is trademark law, which luckily is it's subject to federal law. So I work with clients all over the country, which is fantastic. So I am the mom of two boys. I'm a writer, a small business owner, and of course, an intellectual property attorney. So next slide. Today, I'm just going to give you an overview of intellectual property. Now, I know that intellectual property or IP can be a sexy term, but it also instills a lot of fear in people because they get all the different types of IP confused. So we'll go through a quick overview of trademark, copyright, and patent law, and then we'll talk about trademarks because as you all are emerging business owners and entrepreneurs, the name of your company is extremely important and you want to get it right from the beginning. So trademarks, think your business name and your logo. Trademarks protect the brand elements that identify the source of your goods or your services. So if you think about Nike, which is always a great example to use. Nike has their brand name, which is Nike. Then they have a bunch of submarks. They have their Nike swoosh, which is their logo. They have their tagline, just do it. And then even beyond their big three, they have things like their dry fit trademark, Air Force One, Air Maxes. There are so many different marks under the Nike umbrella. And all of these marks, as soon as you see, you know, Dry Fit or Air Maxes, you know that the source of those products is Nike. So when you think trademark, think about your name and anything that identifies your particular brand. Now, with regard to copyright, think about your creative works. So trademark is your name and logo. Copyright is anything, any of your creative pieces. So if you write a novel, if you film a video in connection with your business, if you have an online course that has multiple recordings, if you're a podcast host, all of those creative works are subject to copyright protection. Now, interestingly, copyright attaches the second those works are created. So if I write a novel right now, I immediately have copyright protection in my novel. The problem is that let's say somebody else takes my novel and tries to pass it off as their own under their name. If I want to take action against that copycat, I need to have a copyright registration in hand from the United States Copyright Office. So even though copyright attaches immediately, if you want to bolster that protection and know that you have the right to go after infringers, you want to make sure that you get the core elements of your business on file with the Copyright Office as soon as possible. So finally, we have patents. And patents are for your innovations, your technological advancements. So think about, this is my very cool ergonomic mouse. And the inner workings of this mouse, this invention, are subject to patent protection. So I don't actually do patent work myself because I'm not an engineer. But the easiest way to think about these three types of intellectual property is to remember that trademark is for your name, copyright is for your creative work, and patent is for your inventions and innovations. So that's a quick overview. So now let's talk trademarks. So as I said, a trademark is any symbol, word, slogan that identifies your goods or services. So we talked about Nike and we said the word Nike is their main trademark. Their phrase, number two on the list above, just do it, is a protectable trademark. Their logo, the swoosh, is a protectable trademark. Other things that people don't often think about that are subject to trademark protection are things like colors, sounds, characters. So as an example, if you think of Tiffany, the jewelry store, that shade of blue that they use for their boxes, that Tiffany blue, that is a registrable trademark. It is protected and it is subject to trademark registration. Similarly, think about Starbucks, that green shade that they use, that is their trademark. If you like fancy shoes, and forgive me for butchering this name, but Christian Louboutin, they have the red sole on the bottom of their shoes. That is actually the subject of trademark litigation worldwide. In some countries, that red sole is a protectable trademark. In others, it's actually not. But that is something that is trademarkable. So think about sounds now. For those of you in the States, NBC, the chimes, and again, forgive me for butchering this, but that dun, 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 that is a protectable trademark. So all of these things that identify the source of your business, those are all protectable trademarks. Again, characters, think Mickey Mouse, right? Mickey Mouse, there's copyright protection in the design, but there is also trademark protection because when you see Mickey, you automatically know that the source of that Mickey is Disney. So lots of different trademarks. And when I'm working with my clients, people are always very nervous about the amount of money and all of these things that they need to protect. We do baby steps. As you're growing your IP portfolio, the first thing you want to do is your name. And we start small. We do your word mark, which is your words only with no stylization or design. That's going to give you the broadest protection and it will protect you however you use your words. As your business grows, as you start making money, then we can slowly add other pieces to your IP portfolio. We can protect your phrases, your colors, your sounds, whatever it may be. And we do that step by step. If you go to the next slide, there are a lot of benefits of registration. And the first and most important is that once you register your mark, you are the presumptive owner of that mark around the United States. What does that mean? That means if somebody comes after you and is starting to use a mark that is either the same as yours or confusingly similar to yours, you just have to show them your trademark registration, and then they have the burden to prove that they're not infringing on your mark. So they might try to say that they are the first user of the mark, because in the United States, the first user of a mark is the person who owns the rights to that trademark. It is not the way it is in other countries, the first person to file an application. So once you have your registration, you are the presumptive owner of the mark, and that's huge. You have exclusive ownership rights in and to your brand. If you don't have that registration, some people look at it as if you're almost just like renting your name. So it's an interesting point and an interesting way to think about it. The other things that registration does for you, you are able to use that registration symbol. So the R that you see up here in the circle, You may only use that mark, that symbol, if you actually have a federally registered trademark. If you use that mark and you don't have a federal registration, it is actually against the law. So if you don't have a registration, but let's say you filed your trademark application, you can use the TM letters in the, you know, top right corner of your mark. But again, you cannot use that registration symbol until your mark is registered. Once you are able to use that, it builds a ton of trust and authenticity in your brand, and it immediately makes your brand more distinctive, more reputable, and more trustworthy. Again, legal leverage and deterrence. As I said, once people know that you are the presumptive owner of that mark, once they see that you're using that registration symbol, you're going to turn away copycats. People are going to be much, much more hesitant to try to infringe on your brand. So deterrence factor is huge. Also, if you have a registered mark in the United States Patent and Trademark Office, the really cool thing is that they almost act as another policing board, because if somebody else comes along and let's say, as you know, my mark is StoryLock Legal. Let's say someone else comes along and tries to register StoryBock Legal. The PTO, if they file an application, is going to say, sorry, StoryBock, but your mark is confusingly similar to StoryLock Legal, and therefore we can't register you. So you get that extra policing from the Patent and Trademark Office, which is awesome. Then the amazing thing is that each of your, if you want to go back just for a second, the final part of this slide is that each registration you have becomes a valuable asset of your company. So with every trademark registration, you are increasing the valuation of your business. So yes, there's a little bit of money involved in getting your mark registered at the outset, but that is increasing the value of your company tenfold. So if you are looking to sell, if you're starting your business knowing that you have an exit strategy plan for 10 years down the road, you want to lock in your IP assets ASAP. All right, next slide. Thank you. Okay, so picking a strong mark. This I could talk about for days on end, but we're going to do it really fast. So when it comes to picking your trademarks, there is a spectrum of distinctiveness. We go from generic marks, which have no protection, to arbitrary and fanciful marks, which are the strongest marks and the kind of marks you want for your business. So the weakest marks, generic marks. If you are a small business owner, for example, and you are selling shoes, you cannot call your business shoes. Simply put, you can't own that common term or prevent anybody else that's selling shoes from using that same mark for their own product, right? Everyone who's selling shoes should be entitled to use the word shoes. So generic marks have no protection, and simply put, you don't want to use them because you're not gonna get anywhere. You're not gonna protect them. You can't prevent anybody else from using them. Very, very weak. The next marks that people often use are descriptive marks. I have here the Container Store. The Container Store is only registered because they were using it for such a long time and acquired fame in the mark that they were able to kind of get past that hump of descriptiveness. But typically, if you are using a trademark that is descriptive, meaning it is somehow imparting a component of your product or describing your product or your service, that's another very, very weak mark. As an example, I work with many female founders. So let's say you're starting a community for female founders, right? And you are calling it, you're calling it Women Female Entrepreneurs Community. Well, community for a community is generic. You can't protect that word. And women entrepreneurs or female entrepreneurs is simply descriptive of the type of community you're creating. You cannot really protect those words. So those are very, very weak marks. So try to stay away from descriptive marks. Next, you'll get further along the scale and you'll get closer to having protectable marks. Suggestive marks are great. Suggestive marks are those that imply or hint about what your good or service might be. So think of a Jaguar as one of my favorite examples. Jaguar, the cars, the name was supposedly picked because jaguars, the animals, are fast and sleek. And Jaguar, the car company, wanted to show that their mark, their car, is fast and sleek. So thus they took this animal to kind of create that association. Copper tone is another one. Copper tone doesn't exactly tell you what the product or service is, but it suggests that it might be some kind of a product that's going to give you a copper tone on your skin. So it requires a little imagination on the part of the consumer. My brand, Storylock Legal, is a suggestive mark. Story, I always say that every trademark tells a story. And lock, I help businesses put a lock on their intellectual property. So there's story lock. So it's suggestive, but it's not descriptive of my services. Your strongest marks are going to be your arbitrary and fanciful marks. So your arbitrary marks are when you take a known common word and you use that word in connection with goods or services that have nothing to do with that word. So the most famous is Apple for computers and phones and earbuds and all of that. Totally no relation between apples and those technology, those products, right? But it has become such a strong trademark because of the messaging and the branding and all of the work that Apple, the company, has done to promote their mark in connection with their goods or services. So those are great marks. And then finally, you have your fanciful marks, which are made up words, simply put, Pepsi, Lululemon, Aloe, Xerox. These are all made up terms, but now when the customers hear them, we know that these marks, these words are used as trademarks for particular goods or services. So I will end on this because I know I don't want to take up anyone else's time. I think I'm almost at my 15 minute mark. I know firsthand, this is one of the main things that my clients come to me with all the time. They want their mark to be descriptive because they feel that that way customers will know what they're selling, or they'll come up in SEO, right? So they'll get a good ranking on Google. There are other ways to do this. Good branding, good messaging, good tagline, good copywriting, all of that will help with those other elements. But if you create a strong brand with an arbitrary, fanciful, or suggestive mark, you will be able to protect your mark. Your trademark will stand the test of time and you will win long-term. The payoff for choosing a distinct mark for your business is, I mean, I can't even express it. It's tremendous. So that's the quick and dirty trademark overview. I hope that you guys enjoyed that. My contact information, I think, is on the next slide. I think. Yes, my email and website are here. And if you want to schedule a consult, feel free to just use that QR code and it'll take you right to my calendar. So thank you all so much, and hopefully be in touch. You can also find me on LinkedIn, and I'm happy to answer any questions for you after the presentation. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Lauren. Our third speaker today is Leslie Cohen, managing partner at All Rise Legal Counsel in Chicago. I wonder if you've trademarked that. It's a very good name. Leslie will be offering her perspective on early stage fundraising, drawing from her extensive experience in corporate and securities law. Leslie, take it away.
Thank you so much for having me. I'll start with a real quick background on myself as well. I came from 7 years of practicing on Wall Street, and then 13 more years at a large firm here in Chicago, where I'm located, before founding All Rise in 2010. We represent startups from seed to exit. So we help with their organization and formation and help you figure out how to divvy up all the founders' equity. And then through the early stage fundraising rounds, which we're going to talk about today. So pre-seed, seed, series A, series B, and then day-to-day contracts and mergers and acquisitions. So if you want to grow by acquisition or get lucky enough to have that big exit. So let's dig in to the fundraising material. The first question that I get asked on a regular basis by clients is, should I raise money from friends and family or should I raise from more serial investors? Is it worth it to go out there looking for those angel funds, more institutional investors? And what you know, there's as anything in life, there's benefits and disadvantages to each. So friends and family, typically what's great about it is you'll figure out the terms of.
I wanted everything here. Is that one? Yeah. I put it, I told.
I think the audio, excuse me, somebody's not on mute. Can you make sure you're all muted?
Great. So the good thing about friends and family raises is you typically will be figuring out the terms of your offering and then going to friends and family and saying, here's what I'm offering. And they will usually, they want to support your business. They want to support you. They're going to not start negotiating all the terms. That makes it a lot easier. On the other hand, there are a lot of advantages to some of these serial investors who may provide you with more strategic advice. They will negotiate the terms. But the other thing is that it's less risky because usually they're very familiar with doing due diligence, looking into your company, and the courts are less protective of them than they would be, say, to, you know, Uncle Milt, who is just doing something as a favor to you, giving you some money. So, and may not be an accredited investor, which is a term of art, which is basically someone who meets very specific income or net worth tests. So that's a few of the good and bad about that. So then people will say to me, okay, so I'm ready for my very first raise. What does that look like? And typically, so with a startup, you're raising money and you'll say, okay, I'm going to sell X number of shares in my company for X dollars, but how do I figure out how much to sell? I'm a brand new company. I don't have any revenue yet. So it's really difficult to value those. And so there are two instruments that are very common. The first one started out many years ago when I started working with startups, which was in 2010. Everyone was using convertible promissory notes. Those are basically promissory notes that you give your investor saying, you don't have to put a valuation on the company. You just say, you're giving me $100,000 in return. I promise to pay you back within usually 1 to 2 years. I'll pay you interest at that point. But if before that maturity date hits, I raise another round of financing where I do have a dollar value on it, where I can figure out at that point, I'm going to sell you X shares for X dollars. That note will convert into your right to be part of that next offering, but at a discount to the price that's paid by the new investors because you took a chance early on. Same thing with a sale of the business. If the business is sold within that period of time before maturity of the note, you basically get to participate. The investor gets to participate in the sale, but on better terms. So that's all great. But what started happening was, you know, as many of you probably know, 1 to 2 years in the life of a startup is a very short period of time. People could not repay their notes. And so there was disgruntled investors. A lot of legal fees went into figuring out maybe to renegotiate the note terms, extend the maturity out a little bit. So this group called Y Combinator out of Silicon Valley came up with the concept of a simple agreement for future equity, a SAFE. And a SAFE does the same thing as a convertible note, but it's not a promissory note. So it's just a piece of paper that says, if and when we raise next round or sell the business, you will get to participate in that with that amount of money you gave us on better terms than the next stage investor or buyer of the business. We can go to the next slide. These are really complicated instruments, and I'm going super fast because I just want to get through the basics. So then typically after someone does a convertible round, which is usually called pre-seed, people think about a Series A as the next round, but I love this sort of unknown, it's getting to be a little more well-known, but something called Series Seed convertible preferred shares. So it's a sort of an in-between round between that seed and that pre-seed and a Series A. It does give the investor the right to buy X number of shares for X dollars. And it gives them a lot of different rights in your business, preferred rights. They get paid back before the common shareholders and a bunch of other rights that are on the slide, but it's nowhere, doesn't give them anywhere near the rights that a Series A holder gets in your company. So we can go to the next slide. If you, when you sell Series A preferred shares, you have to know that the investor in those shares is going to have a lot of rights in your company. They're going to get a board seat, and they're going to have, they're basically going to become like a partner in your business. They're going to have approval rights over so many things that you would like to do running your business day to day. So you just have to be very, very careful. They're giving you a lot of money and they want protections. And as long as you're making your numbers and doing well, that's terrific. If not, they're going to jump in and take control in a lot of ways over your business. So you have to be very careful. Let's go to the next slide. So what clients want to know when they come to me is also, okay, so I'm going to do this. I'm going to start out doing this safe round. What do I need to give investors? What do I need to worry about? Some lawyer told me that, you know, one lawyer told me I just print the form of safe off the Y Combinator website and fill in the discount and or the valuation cap and I'm good to go. And another lawyer told me, no, you're selling, excuse me, you're selling securities. You need to register with the SEC. You need to do a private placement memorandum. You're talking about, you know, $20,000 in legal fees. And the answer is really somewhere in between. Yes, you are selling securities. Anytime someone gives you money and expects you to turn that money into a profit for them and they're sort of, you know, passive investors, you're selling a security. Excuse me. So you need to have, and the securities laws require you to register with the SEC unless you have an exemption from registration. So you've probably all heard a lot about this Reg D offerings. That's the exemption from registration that you're going to depend on. And when that, what that basically means is under one of the 4A2 of the 33 Act, what it means is you're conducting a private offering, not selling to the public. And therefore, you don't have to register with the SEC. So there are a bunch of different rules under Regulation D to make sure that you comply with these rules. And the two that are probably most applicable to all of you listening, if you're a startup, is one is Rule 506B, which says basically, as long as you're selling to, you can sell however much money in securities, as long as you're selling to no more than 35 non-accredited investors. Again, those are people who don't meet certain income or net worth tests, then you're fine. But the other thing is you cannot go out on social media anywhere in public and say, you know, come invest in our company. We don't know you, but we're great. Come, you know, give us your money. We're going to turn it into more money. So that's called a general solicitation. You have to have some relationship beforehand with your investors. Doesn't mean it has to be your best friend since kindergarten. It can be, you know, someone your lawyer introduces you to, someone, you know, that you meet through someone else, but it just cannot be going out there in to the world and saying to the public, I'm selling securities. The other alternative is 506C, which does allow you to do that. You can go on social media and say that you're selling, that you're, you know, offering investors interest in your company. But the difference there is every one of your investors has to be accredited investors. They must meet those net worth or net income tests. And then there's crowdfunding, which is done through SEC registered portals like WeFunder, and they allow you to raise $1 million a year. And with those, your investors don't have to be accredited. So sometimes people will say they've got a lot of friends or family that want to invest. They're not accredited investors. And it's a, you know, one of your options would be to go through a crowdfunding campaign. And keep in mind, this is not Kickstarter where you're offering on crowdfunding a, you know, merchandise or you know, early access to your product. This is really just if you're offering actual ownership of some kind in your business. The next slide, please. So then what is the next big question is, okay, Leslie, so what do I need to give to my investors? What do I need to protect myself? And the answer is you need a subscription agreement. This is my answer. You need a subscription agreement, which tells all your investors sign saying, I'm investing in, you know, I'm putting in $100,000 to this company. I understand that this is a very early stage company, that I may lose my money. I've talked to my lawyers and financial people. They think this is fine for me. I've talked to the founders. They've answered all my questions. It's a form document, basically. And then I attach two exhibits to that. One exhibit is a basic description of the company. You can use your deck. The most important exhibit that I attach is a set of risk factors, because what the securities laws also require, besides that exemption that we talked about, Reg D, is that you tell investors anything that a reasonable person would want to know in making this investment decision. And so by having these risk factors, you're telling people that, you know, all these things could go wrong. So if someone was to lose their money on your that investment in your company, and, you know, be angry with you and hire a lawyer, the first thing the lawyer is going to say is, well, did you sign any documentation? Yeah, I signed this. And it said there's a huge competitor out there and we may not have the same resources, and that may be, you know, doomsday for our business. We think we have a better product, but, you know, who knows? And so the lawyer is going to say, I'm not taking that case because you're going to lose. And so that's, you know, those are the documents that I think are, and then in addition to that Y Combinator safe itself, I think that provides you the optimal protection under the securities laws, while at the same time, you know, making sure that you're not spending a ridiculous amount of money unnecessarily in legal fees. I'll finish real quick by, I have that on the subscription agreement slide. Sorry about that. Can you go back to the last slide? I just want to make two quick points. One is that if someone comes to you and says that they have a whole network of high net worth individuals and they're going to help you raise money, be very, very, very careful. Those people are finders. They're supposed to be registered broker dealers. If they're not registered, you could have aiding and abetting liability. There are a lot of people out there like this, and there are exceptions to the rule, but, you know, talk to a lawyer before you engage anyone like that. Excuse me. And the last thing I'll say is that there are, under that Regulation D, you have to make a filing with the SEC. It's just an information filing. It's not extensive. It doesn't, you know, give away too much inside information, and it's not very expensive to file, but it is something important. And each state has a copycat of those federal rules. And so you need to comply with those as well. And each state is different. New York, for instance, requires, it's driven by where your investors are. So if you're raising money from a resident of New York, it's about a $1,200 fee, and you have to file that same document that you filed federally. If you're talking about Florida, there's no filing at all required. So it's really different state on a state-by-state basis. And you can look at my other slides, have some additional information. Like everyone else here, I am so happy to help answer questions and really appreciate you all being here, and a free half hour one-on-one consultation on anything. Here's my contact information, and thank you for the opportunity.
Thanks so much, Leslie. That was really informative. Our final presenter today is Christina Coleman of Coleman Immigration in Chicago. Christina specializes in immigration pathways for entrepreneurs, and she's here to provide guidance on how to navigate this critical aspect of building a business. Christina, over to you. I think you might be on mute.
Well, that would help. Hi, I'm Christina Coleman. I'm an attorney based here in Chicago, but like Lauren, Immigration is a federal area, so we have clients all over the country. I'm actually an immigrant myself. I came to the United States to go to graduate school. In the next 15 minutes, I'm going to review some common options for early stage startups. Immigration is an incredibly complex field, and there is a lot more to talk about than what I'm going to be able to cover today. I hope you'll be able to use my slides as a resource. And like everybody else, as Leslie was saying, we're all prepared or eager to talk to you about questions you might have. So immigrant entrepreneurs, as we all know, play a huge role in our economy. Almost 50% of Fortune 500 companies were founded by immigrants or the children of immigrants. But the pathway to hiring a foreign national has a lot of aspects to it. There are considerations. The first one I would say is the biggest overarching is really timing. Delays and backlogs in securing visa appointments cause so many headaches, you know, planning problems, the ability to forecast for business owners. In some countries, the delays are massive. We see long delays at USCIS, which is the immigration service inside the United States. We've seen some improvement. There's been an expansion of their premium processing program for some visa categories. And that means you get to pay an additional $2,805. And they might process your visa or your application a little faster, or at least send you a message about what you forgot to put in it within 3 weeks. We're also in kind of a volatile political landscape on immigration. We saw some improvements in this administration, but business-based administration is not going away. Despite, you know, it was on the front page of the New York Times today, you know, what are the different candidates going to do in terms of immigration? But for business-based immigration, while we might see some changes, we could see some changes to the H-1B program, which is one of the most popular and prominent visa programs available. We may see increased fees. We could see downs. It's not going anywhere, but I do encourage you even more now than ever to start planning as early as you can. And whether that's hiring a freshly minted college graduate or bringing in talent from your subsidiary abroad, you really need to start planning as soon as you can. Just going to touch on terminology for 1 minute for those of you who may not be as familiar with immigration. There's a big distinction between non-immigrant and immigrant visas. Non-immigrant visas have a specific end date. They're issued for a specific purpose. Generally, they are tied to a specific employer. So if you're the sponsoring employer, typically your foreign national individual can't use the visa you got to go and work for someone else. That's also a question I get a lot. Immigrant visas are basically green cards. And most people need to get a non-immigrant visa first, and then they can progress to maybe getting a green card through employment. And because we're mainly talking about startups today, we're going to focus on the non-immigrant pathways, but it's just an interesting, people talk about immigrants all the time. A lot of foreign nationals here are not immigrants, they are non-immigrants. So that's an important distinction. So let's go to the next slide and talk a little bit about work authorization and how you get it. So if we can just go to the next slide, I'm going to talk about not everybody needs a visa to enter the U.S. There are a lot of countries that are included in, it's called the visa waiver program, and you can come for up to 90 days for business purposes. Nope, still on the slide before, talking about business visitors. Business visitors can come and handle, you know, a lot of things that might be kind of baby steps towards setting up your company or getting your non-immigrant visa. So you're allowed to come, you can negotiate contracts, you can secure funding, you could get your office space set up, you can meet with clients. The main thing is you can't be doing productive work here. So what is work? That's a great gray area. There's a big debate about, well, what if I'm an employee foreign entity? Can I come to the US and work remotely? That could be an hour-long panel, but the short answer is no. So eventually you're going to have to, if you're the person who needs the visa or you're hiring someone who needs a visa, who needs work authorization, I should say, they are eventually going to have to move on from that business visitor visa. It's not going to be enough. So in the next slide, I'm just mentioning students because students who come, international students who come, and this is how I came here myself, actually had one of these work cards. You get a year. Bachelor's level program, and people who do STEM get an additional 2 years, and it's a great option because employers, you don't have to file anything, you don't have to pay anything, there is no prevailing wage, you don't have to do a great way to hire new lots of programs, but eventually they too are going to run out of time, and it's amazing how quickly those 3 years fly by. So the typical sort of logical next step on the next slide is the H-1B visa program. And the H-1B visa program is probably the most prominent, well-known program for work authorization. You do have to have three main things. The individual who's being sponsored must have a four-year bachelor's degree. It doesn't have to be from the States, but it does have to be the equivalent of an American degree. And that means it has to be evaluated. The position has to require that degree. Be like, well, I have a degree in chemistry and I'm going to, you know, work in marketing. You know, it has to be related. And you do have to pay the prevailing wage, which can be a bit of a pain because the Department of Labor really increases those fees every year. And we saw them go up a lot. The other big issue with H-1Bs is there is a limited number of them available every year. And so it's kind of a race to apply. They instituted, USCIS instituted a lottery about 5 years ago that happens in March for an employment start date of October. So you really have to plan in advance for these. So basically in January, I'm talking to people, you've got to have your FEIN, you have to have your business set up, you have to make sure, you know, we can pay the prevailing wage, let's see what it is so that we're ready for the lottery. And if you go to the next slide, it's interesting. You can't self-sponsor, but you can set up a legally autonomous entity. And maybe you're going to call Ivan. You're going to talk to Ivan. How am I going to do this? But so long as that entity has some control, you could set up a board of directors maybe. So you have to show that someone, you're reportable to somebody. So it's not just you. So it's not a self-petition, but it is a nice little workaround. And another thing that's great for H-1Bs is you can do them for part-time. It does not have to be a full-time. So you could say, oh, I'm going to just do 15 hours. There are some issues about that, a little bit things you got to be aware of, but it is a nice little advantage to the H-1B. Let's just go to the next slide so you can see the crazy increase in the amount of H-1B petitions over the last several years. So yeah, we're gonna go to the next slide and talk about, well, what if my H-1B registration doesn't get selected or my employees, I filed for them. There are some very specific visas for specific country types. I'm not gonna dwell on these because it's only four for these ones, but the TN visa, which is Mexico and Canada, hopefully it makes it, survives, but it's a great one, but you have to be in a specific occupation. They are fantastic for engineers. So if you need engineers, TN is your friend. But I'm going to keep next slide to talk about E1s because E1 and E2, these are great for all kinds of different business ventures. They're typically processed through the State Department. They are also limited to certain countries, but there's, you know, 70 countries that have these, and you'd be surprised. And we'll look in a minute, but I'm just going to stay on the slide for a second. It's interesting. It's available. They're basically individual treaties that are negotiated between the State Department and the country. So you go through, see, and I mainly want to talk about E2s because basically, an individual from one of these countries can make an investment, and it's not even that much of an investment, maybe $100,000, either setting up a new entity in the United States or purchasing a majority stake in a U.S. business that's already set up. You do not need to have a foreign entity at all. You are to set up a U.S. entity. So again, you're going to be calling up Ivan. We're going to be getting it set up. Problem is, the person who is making the investment has to show the investment came from the country they're from, and they're going to retain a majority stake. So you're not going to call Leslie and say, let's do some fundraising with Americans, because that's going to dilute your ownership. And that's one of the main disadvantages of an E2. So You just have to be a little careful, but overall, we do tons of these. They are fantastic. You don't, there's really almost no limit to the type of entity you could use. Your spouse gets automatic work authorization for the entire time that you are there. You can renew them almost ad infinitum. I've got a French guy who's on like his seventh E2. They're usually good for up to 5 years at a time. They're really great. There's, you know, some drawbacks, and I've listed them out here. You really have to know your embassy that you're dealing with, because each embassy has its own special rules. Some of them are so old, like the one with Britain was, you know, negotiated 150 years ago in 1882 or something. There's some weird little wackiness. So you kind of have to work with someone who knows the various embassies. But they are really a wonderful option if you fall into the right country category. You can send yourself, you can send a manager, you can send essential employees, you can hire a whole bunch of people, so long as they have the same treaty nationality as you. So let's look at the next slide, and we will quickly, and you know, this is going to be in your packet. You know, obviously this is valid as of today. These do change once in a while, like Israel just got the E1, like some come and go. It's an interesting study of American diplomacy to see what countries do and do not have these treaties. In terms of timing, you got to know your embassy, right? Some embassies, most Western European embassies, you know, 4 to 6 months. Holland, who knows why, taking a year. Canada, 3 months. It comes and goes, it fluctuates. So if you're going to use it, again, it's always about planning ahead and also just being ready with your business set up. So maybe you're going to use that business visitor status to come and get your office sort of going. So let's go to the next slide. I'm going to very quickly talk about L1 new offices. There is a standard L1, which is if you already have an established foreign entity and a US entity, you can move high-level managers and specialized workers between those companies. But if you don't have a US entity yet, but you have a foreign subsidiary, you can set up a US entity using an L1 new office. And these are great in the circumstances they apply to. They work really well. They are only good for a year. If we go to the next slide, one nice thing about the L1 new office, you can then convert to an L1A, and you have that nice dual intent. Your spouse gets a work authorization. There's no minimum salary. You can own some of it. You do have to be operating at a pretty high level by the time you're ready to convert. So let's go to the next slide. And I'm not really going to have time to talk about these, but there is another category for business people who have been doing amazing things out in their field. And we can demonstrate, maybe you have a patent for something really cool and you've been selling it, or there's lots of media articles about what you've been up to. We can look at the O1A. And similarly, in the next two slides, I just included some information about the international entrepreneur parole rule, which has been kicking around for a while, but it was suspended by the last administration. So you might hear about it. It would be helpful to have information about it. But they're really just starting to kick off now. We haven't seen any be approved yet. Like, as a community, we talk a lot about these immigration attorneys. So let's go ahead two slides past international entrepreneur parole, and then we're here. So eventually you run out of time on your non-immigrant visa. You are going to eventually have to either get a different type of non-immigrant visa or get a green card. And that is another whole can of worms, and they take a long time. And unfortunately, I'm almost out of time. You typically, though, just so you know, you will be in a category when you apply. And if you go to the next slide, you can see every category has a waiting period. Some of them are current, and that's what the C means in this next slide, which is called the visa bulletin. But you can also see that in some of the categories, there's a very long wait. And that's my timer telling me I'm out of time, so I'm gonna stop. But when people talk about, like, hey, these huge delays, this is what they are talking about. So most people, though, you know, you if you go to the very last slide or the slide, the penultimate slide, you don't get to just come and say, oh, I've lived here 10 years, I'm ready to be a citizen. It is a journey. It is a process. Most people start with non-immigrant visas, then you've got to get your green card. You don't ever have to become a citizen if you don't want to, but it is a long journey. So try to choose someone who understands your business goals, because you're going to be going through this hopefully with more than one person. You're going to get to hire lots of amazing foreign nationals that are out there. And I hope I haven't scared you all. And the main thing is, though, start early, start planning, make sure you rely on your whole team that we have assembled here today for all the aspects of your business. And thank you so much for having me today.
Thank you, Christina. Gosh, we got a lot of invaluable information about how to your legal parameters for being a founder. So thank you to all of you. We do have some time to open up to questions. Feel free to put your questions in the chat. I've collected a couple of them. Hold on, I gotta try to find them in a second. One of them was from Oscar Schrag. I believe this is for Leslie. What needs to be set up or reported when receiving government grant funding?
So government grants are not, it's not selling securities of any kind. So it's there's whatever the requirements of the grant itself. And other than that, there's really nothing from a securities law perspective. You're not grants, you're being given money. You're not, they're not expecting you to turn it into some kind of a, you know, more money where you, and you don't own any part of the business. So there's nothing.
Okay, great. And then there was a question, I believe, for Lauren. If you have used a business name, logo, and slogan for many years, but never trademarked, and another business uses the same later on and trademarks, who owns it?
This is a great question. This is why I always tell clients to file your trademark applications as soon as you start your business.
Maya, stop.
Oh, so the challenge here is that if you have been using your mark for years, technically, you are the first user if you were the first person to use that mark. However, if you have not taken action to register your trademark, the PTO doesn't know about you. The PTO, sorry, is the U.S. Patent and Trademark Office. So let's say that somebody else comes along and doesn't do their due diligence, doesn't see that you're already out here using the mark, and they begin using a mark and file their application with the PTO. The PTO might give them the registration because they don't know about the first user. So now the first user has to go to the PTO and essentially petition to challenge this application or registration if the mark has already registered. And then you're essentially in a litigation spending tens of thousands of dollars trying to get ownership of your name, which you own because you were the first user. So it gets to be a really sticky and very expensive battle. And your best bet is always, always, always do a comprehensive search before you move forward with your name so that you know your name is clear and available. And then file your trademark application as soon as possible. If you haven't started using the mark yet in commerce, you can file what's called an intent to use application and then convert it later. But you want to get your applications on file and get registered as soon as possible so that you don't face challenges down the road. The last thing you want as a small new business owner is an ownership battle. It's just, we want to be proactive, not reactive. And there's so many ways to prevent all of these extra costs and headaches down the road. So, yeah.
Right. Thank you. That's very helpful. The next question, if you're applying for a job in the U.S. as a foreign national, oh, this is for Christina, by the way, I probably could have figured that out with some context clues. If you're applying for a job in the U.S. as a foreign national with no current work authorization in the U.S., do you have to wait for the next H-1B lottery to be able to start working, even if you have a job offer?
Yes, unfortunately, the job offer by itself is not enough to start working. And not only do you have to wait for the lottery, you have to be selected in the lottery, file your petition, and then wait till October the 1st, which is when the fiscal year for USCIS begins, and all H-1B lotteries that go through the cap are for a start date of October 1st. So ideally, maybe you're in the U.S. on another status, like an F-1, and you can work on your EAD, but if you have no work authorization at all. You got to be really careful because if you violate your status, you may never be able to get a visa after that. So yeah, sadly, yes, you have to wait.
There's a two-part question for you as well, Christina. Can an H-1B visa holder start a company and have majority ownership is the first part of that question.
So that's what I was talking about a little bit. And this is probably maybe a bit granular. I know we don't have that much time, but you can start a company, but you would need to set it up in a way that you are reporting to somebody. Ideally, you know, it's always better if you do have a partner, but you could start your own company. But you're going to have to prove to the US that you have enough work lined up to sustain yourself, and you do have to be paid the prevailing wage. So I know your question is probably a little more nuanced than that, but I'm cognizant of the fact there's a lot of other questions. But yes, it's possible with a bunch of caveats. So feel free to send me an email.
And there's a second part of the question. What are the options for the H-1B visa holder if their startup doesn't make any money yet and therefore can't draw a salary? Can you invest?
Yeah, I was trying to address, I saw the question in the chat. So I think I kind of addressed that. Okay. Already.
Sorry. Okay, great.
Sorry. Thanks. No, that's okay. It's a tough one.
I think that if anybody has any other questions, please put them in the chat. And I think that Jess might have a question.
I have a question. I used to work in legal, so I used to get asked this a lot. So I kind of want to bring it up while Leslie and Christina are here. Someone had mentioned grants, so I kind of wanted to mention, when you're talking about the different types of funding, like crowdsourcing, and when you get a grant or you get investment, like a safe investment from an accredited investor, what that looks like when it comes to like filing a petition, like let's say for 01A criteria, what are the differences there? Christina, if you want to go into that a little bit.
I mean, a government grant like or what, an interest. Oh, sorry, go ahead.
Yeah. I mean, like a government grant, how does that qualify for like awards, for example, for the 01A? What does that look like versus crowdfunding or crowdsourcing, from an accredited investor, or versus getting a government grant?
Right. So, well, I'm not going to address it in the international entrepreneurial parole sphere. There are specific grants that work for that. But again, this is, you know, I'm going to stick to the O1, which is you can use it as proof of an award. You can use it if you're in a field of critical and emerging technology to show government interest. You can use it in a national interest waiver context. And I'm sorry, we didn't have time to go into that, but definitely receiving government interest. I mean, you can also even just have government interest or a quasi-government agency interest to bolster your national interest waiver petition. So definitely, you know, any kind of grants. And then we've used other types of funding, just, you know, like in a more, it's called comparable evidence, but you can use it in a way just to show that there's a great interest and a great need for the work you're doing. So yeah, definitely, definitely nothing but positives there from an immigration perspective.
Thank you.
Here's another question. Again, Christina, suppose a US citizen is incorporating a new organization in the US and the co-founder is, for example, an Australian national who will work remotely, wouldn't be immigration, so he would be immigrating to the US. What kind of, are there any complications or requirements that you need to think about?
So if the Australian is never going to come here, then nothing to worry about. If the Australian eventually wanted to come here, you have a couple of options. One is, you know, if the Australian was a majority stakeholder, even like 55 or 52%, then you could do an E, so long as you could show the money coming from Australia. If your company grows and eventually you want the Australian to come here, you could sponsor them for an H-1B if they fit, you know, in that role. But so long as they're staying in Australia, fortunately, at this time, the U.S. government is not allowed to regulate what people do in other countries in terms of work. So you don't have to do anything from a tax perspective, you know, how that person draws benefits and stuff or dividends. You got to talk to your corporate immigration and probably your tax folks, but if, from an immigration perspective, so long as they're remote, they could come over on a B1 and do, you know, occasional meetings. They could go to quarterly meetings and stuff, but yeah, you should be fine.
And this looks like the last question. Could you elaborate, Christina, a little on the qualifications and process for an O-1 visa?
So the O-1, you know, you still do need a sponsor. You need an employer sponsor to do an O-1. It's an exceptional ability type visa. So there's actually criteria that are out, and I don't remember if I had them on the slide, but they are also on the USCIS website, which in recent years has improved quite a bit. But you show that you qualify, you can use certain criteria such as publications, either by you or about you. I had one. I've done some awesome O-1s. O-1s are great. You can be super creative. We did one for a celebrity dog trainer. We did one for a whiskey distiller. We did one for a chef. So one of the things that's fun is you can use social media influencers. Like you sort of show how you've got this giant following on, I mean, I wouldn't say TikTok, I'm not that cool, but on Instagram, we did one with Instagram. And you know, articles about you, the fact that you've been able to raise money, you've gotten grants, that you've won prizes, other types of prizes, you've reviewed the work of your peers, maybe you've been on a judging panel for some kind of award. So all kinds of different stuff. There's a nice little catch-all category called comparable evidence, but it on USCIS's webpage, which is just uscis.gov, they actually lay out all the criteria for you. You know, we always get recommendation letters from other people in the field. It's usually a pretty fat packet. But there's definitely, and you apply, you have a sponsor, either an employer or an agent applies for you. There's a couple of little extras you have to get to show that the professional organization for that that particular group in the United States doesn't object to your coming. It's an advisory opinion. And they're good for up to at a time, and then you can renew them, and there's no cap. So they're a fun one. They're a lot of work, but they're usually we usually like them. So thanks for those questions. Those are great questions.
Great. Well, I want to thank Ivan, Lauren, Leslie, and Christina so much for taking their time, giving us their time, sharing their expertise today. Before we close, we'd really appreciate it if you could take a moment to fill out our brief event survey with the QR code. Your feedback is invaluable to us, and it really helps us improve future events, hearing what you like, what you want to see more of, et cetera. With that, I say thank you to everyone for joining us today, and best of luck in your climate career journey.